Hello and welcome back to the channel and this special Christmas video, which has to do with something that was a big part of my childhood and probably yours as well. In 1960, Arthur Rankin Jr. was working as an art director and Jules Bass was working as a copywriter, both for the American Broadcasting Company. They initially worked on creating commercials together, but in 1960 they branched out into television series and films when they established their own company called Videocraft International, which in 1968 was rebranded Rankin-Bass Productions. The first television series they created in 1960 was The New Adventures of Pinocchio, which utilized stop-motion puppetry in a process that would be dubbed animagic. Nearly all of the animation in the Rankin-Bass Productions was outsourced to Japan, to several different animation companies, including Toei Animation, Mushi Productions, and Topcraft. Topcraft is significant because after that studio dissolved in 1985, several animators from Topcraft, including Hayao Miyazaki, formed Studio Ghibli. Much of the stop-motion animagic work throughout the 1960s was done by Japanese animator Tadahito Moshinaga, who is credited as Tad Moshinaga in several of Rankin-Bass's productions. Rankin-Bass often collaborated with the same talented people on their specials, including musical director Maury Laws and screenwriter Romeo Mueller. Rankin-Bass would go on to produce a number of popular films and shows over the next two decades, including The King Kong Show in 1966, Mad Monster Party in 1967, the animated adaptation of J.R.R. Tolkien's The Hobbit in 1977, as well as The Return of the King in 1980. They produced two well-remembered fantasy films in 1982, The Last Unicorn and The Flight of Dragons. And in the mid-1980s, they entered the realm of toy line adaptations with Thundercats in 1985, Silverhawks in 1986, and an anthology show in 1987 called The Comic Strip, which included a segment for the Tiger Sharks. But what Rankin-Bass are most remembered for are the plethora of holiday specials that they produced over the years. There was one for Thanksgiving called The Mouse on the Mayflower in 1968, and three Easter specials. Here Comes Peter Cottontail in 1971, The First Easter Rabbit in 1976, and The Easter Bunny Is Coming to Town in 1977. But when people hear the name Rankin-Bass, what they probably go to most and first are the Christmas specials. Rankin and Bass produced 18 animated Christmas specials between 1964 and 1985. In this video, I'm going to look at the seven Christmas specials that are known to exist in the same continuity. Starting with Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer, first aired on December 6, 1964. It was based on a song released by Johnny Marks in 1949, which was in turn based on a poem created by Marks' brother-in-law, Robert L. May, in 1939. The Rudolph special took the basic premise of the song and expanded it into an entire world full of fantasy and fantastic creatures. The little reindeer Rudolph is born with a glowing red nose, which makes him an outcast in Santa's village. Deciding to run away from home, Rudolph meets up with an elf named Hermie, who, unlike the other elves, has no desire to make toys and would rather be a dentist. On their travels, the two meet the gregarious prospector Yukon Cornelius. As the three travel together looking for a place to belong, they are stalked by the fearsome, abominable snow monster. Their travels take them to the island of Misfit Toys, ruled over by a kindly winged lion named King Moonracer. Eventually, Rudolph returns home, where Santa and the other citizens of Christmastown realize that Rudolph's difference is actually his strength. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer stars the voices of Burl Ives as the narrator Sam the Snowman, Billy Mae Richards as Rudolph, Larry Mann as both Yukon Cornelius and the Abominable Snow Monster, Paul Soles as Hermie the Elf, Mr. Soles would go on to voice Peter Parker in the 1967 Spider-Man animated series, and Stan Francis as both Santa and King Moonracer. Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer would establish many things that would become commonplace in the Rankin-Bass holiday specials, such as a celebrity narrator, multiple musical numbers based on both existing songs and original material, and themes like friendship, love, and believing in magic. The next stop on our journey is December 7th, 1969, and the premiere of Frosty the Snowman, based on a song by Walter E. Rollins and Steve Nelson. Frosty the Snowman is the story of a snowman who came to life thanks to a magical top hat. Frosty has a great time playing with the town's children, but when the temperature rises, Frosty knows that he will melt away unless he gets to a colder climate. Frosty and the children decide that he needs to get to the North Pole, but on his journey he is stalked by the wicked Professor Hinkle, the two-bit magician who originally threw away Frosty's hat, not realizing that it was actually magic, and now Hinkle wants the hat back. Frosty the Snowman is done in traditional cell animation rather than stop-motion puppetry. The look of the special is thanks to artist Paul Coker Jr., a Christmas card designer who created both the characters and the backgrounds for this special. Voices include the narrator, Jimmy Durante, Jackie Vernon as Frosty, Billy DeWolf as Professor Hinkle, June Foray as Karen, and June would go on to voice Rocky the Flying Squirrel in the Rocky and Bullwinkle show, and Paul Frees as the traffic cop and Santa Claus. And you'll be hearing the name Paul Frees several more times during this video. He was one of the Rankin-Bass voice actor MVPs throughout their run. December 13th, 1970 saw the debut of Santa Claus is Coming to Town, based on a song written by J. Fred Coots and Haven Gillespie. This special serves as an origin story for the legend of Santa Claus. One night, a baby is left on the doorstep of a kind family of elves called the Kringles. The baby has no identification, save for a small tag around his neck with one word on it, Claus. The matriarch of the clan, Tanta Kringle, decides to name the baby Chris, and they raise him as one of their own and teach him their special craft of making toys. Unfortunately, the Kringles cannot get their toys to children that would love them because they cannot make the long journey over the mountain to nearby villages. When Chris is a man, he takes it upon himself to deliver the Kringles toys. Along the way, he encounters a lost little penguin named Topper, the seemingly wicked Winter Warlock, and the Burgermeister Meisterburger, the tyrannical leader of a village called Sombertown, who has declared toys to be illegal. Chris, believing that all children should have toys, tries to devise new and clever ways to get the Kringles toys to the town's children. Along the way, he encounters the town's school teacher, Miss Jessica. At first, Miss Jessica admonishes Chris for breaking the town's laws, but she eventually comes around to helping Chris and eventually falls in love with him. Santa Claus is Coming to Town is an origin story for basically everything in the Santa Claus legend. Why is he known by Claus and Kringle? Why does he go down chimneys? Why does he leave toys in stockings? How do the reindeer fly? All these questions and more are answered. Our narrator this time around is Fred Astaire, voicing Special Delivery S.D. Kluger, the North Pole mailman that brings all the children's letters to Santa every year. Mickey Rooney stars as Santa Claus, aka Kris Kringle. Keenan Wynn plays the Winter Warlock. Robbie Lester is Miss Jessica. And Paul Frees is back as the Burgermeister Meisterburger. Although several voice actors play the character of Santa Claus across the various Rankin-Bass Christmas specials, Mickey Rooney would play it three times and is the voice most associated with the role. And his second time playing Santa was on December 10th, 1974, in The Year Without a Santa Claus, based on a 1956 book by Phyllis McGinley. In this story, Santa Claus has become despondent over what he perceives to be the lack of Christmas spirit in a world that is growing more jaded and cynical. He comes down with a cold around Christmas time and decides that he's going to take a year off, believing that no one will miss him. Mrs. Claus, believing that Santa is wrong, sends two elves, Jingle and Jangle, out into the world to find Christmas spirit and prove to Santa that he is still wanted. Jingle and Jangle land in Southtown, USA, but find that the people there, including the children, have a hard time believing that Santa still exists. In addition to Mickey Rooney returning as Santa, Shirley Booth voices Mrs. Claus and is also the narrator. Voicing two of the most memorable characters from the Rankin-Bass Christmas specials are Dick Shawn as the Snow Miser and George S. Irving as the Heat Miser. On December 2nd, 1976, Frosty the Snowman returned in Frosty's Winter Wonderland. Jackie Vernon returned as Frosty, with Andy Griffith taking the role as the narrator. It's winter again, and Frosty has returned to town to play with his old friends, the children. But when night falls and all the children return home, Frosty is left outside all alone. When the children realize how lonely he is, they create a snow wife for him, who he names Crystal. Crystal, voiced by Shelley Winters, also comes to life and becomes Frosty's snow wife. But there is one person who is not happy with Frosty's return, and that is Jack Frost, voiced by Paul Frees. On December 10th, 1976, the little reindeer that started it all finally returned with Rudolph's Shiny New Year. After Christmas, Santa Claus receives a letter from his friend Father Time, asking for help to find the baby New Year before midnight on New Year's Eve, or else it will be December 31st forever. It seems Happy, the baby New Year, has run away, due to the fact that people have been laughing at him for his unusually large ears. Santa sends Rudolph to go out and find Happy, as the snowstorm from the original Rudolph special is still happening, and Rudolph is the only one that can navigate it with his glowing red nose. But Rudolph is not the only one looking for the New Year baby. A giant evil vulture named Eon the Terrible, who lives for one Eon, as his name suggests, is also looking for Happy, as on December 31st, his Eon will be up, and as soon as the clock strikes 12 on January 1st, he will turn to ice and snow. So Eon plans to kidnap Happy and keep the year from ending, thus prolonging his life. Billy Mae Richards returns as the voice of Rudolph, with Red Skelton playing the narrator Father Time, and Paul Frees back again to play Eon the Terrible. In his search for Happy, Rudolph makes various allies along the way who represent different eras in time. Maury Amsterdam voices the caveman 1 million BC. Frank Gorshin voices the old knight, Sir 1023. And in another role, Paul Frees voices the Ben Franklin lookalike, 1776. And Rudolph also receives help from a great whale with a clock named Big Ben, voiced by Harold Peary. The seventh and last special we're looking at debuted on November 25th, 1979. And that is Rudolph and Frosty, Christmas in July. This is the special that brought back many of the main characters from the shows we just looked at and established that they all lived in the same continuity. Billy Mae Richards returns again as Rudolph, and Jackie Vernon again as Frosty, Shelley Winters as Crystal, and Mickey Rooney reprising his role again as Santa Claus. Other voices include Red Buttons as Milton the Ice Cream Man, Paul Frees once again playing the villainous Winterbolt, Nellie Bellflower as Lady Boreal, and Ethel Merman as Lily Lorraine. Ethel Merman as Lily Lorraine. Rudolph and Frosty Christmas in July is best remembered for teaming up all the various characters from the previous specials, which include cameos from Jingle and Jangle, from Year Without a Santa Claus, Jack Frost from Frosty's Winter Wonderland, and Big Ben from Rudolph's Shiny New Year. But it is also remembered for having a very convoluted plot. And with a longer running time than the previous specials, the story doesn't always flow all that smoothly. The basic premise is that Rudolph and Frosty's friend from the North Pole, Milton the Ice Cream Man, is despondent about not being able to marry his one true love, Lainey Lorraine, an acrobat at a circus down south that is owned by her mother, Lily Lorraine. The circus is on the verge of going out of business, so Rudolph, Frosty, Crystal, and Frosty and Crystal's two children, Millie and Chili, decide to head down south and help save the circus. The evil Winterbolt sees this as an opportunity to extinguish the magic in Rudolph's nose, magic given to Rudolph by Winterbolt's old enemy, Lady Boreal. Rudolph's magic is the only thing standing in the way of Winterbolt driving Santa out of the North Pole and taking control for himself. That's the basic gist of the story. There's a lot more to it, but like I said, it gets really complicated. But we do finally get an origin story for why Rudolph's nose glows. Rankin and Bass Productions shut down in the year 2000. And since then, there have been several attempts at continuing and recreating the Rankin-Bass specials in stop motion, CGI, and even live action. But I don't think any of those attempts was able to quite capture the magic of the original specials from the 1960s and 70s. The Rankin-Bass animated Christmas properties are perennial favorites for merchandising around the holidays. This is all stuff I found recently. Coloring books, little golden books, various candies, and finger puppets, and there are also plenty of ornaments available. But for a time at the turn of the century, you could get full action figure lines based on the Rankin-Bass holiday classics. In 2001, the company Memory Lane began releasing a full line of action figures based on the original marionettes from Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. And when I say full line, I mean a full line. They produced figures for virtually every single major and minor character seen in that special, including all the elves and all the misfit toys. Most figures came individually carded, but Memory Lane also did a variety of different box sets with different combinations of figures. There was also a set featuring Yukon Cornelius and his full dog sled team, two sets featuring Santa's sleigh, both with and without his team of eight reindeer, a vignette featuring Rudolph's family in the cave where he was born, and there was also a massive Santa's Castle playset. This Rudolph series of toys stands as the most extensive line of toys ever produced for a Rankin-Bass holiday special. As we see here, I have three characters from that Rudolph action figure line. Young Rudolph is a pretty basic 5POA figure. He can move his legs back and forth, and he can turn his head. But of course, he also has that light up nose feature by pressing his tail. And I appreciate they worked that feature in without sacrificing any movement in the head. I assume there are some wires that lead back through his body, so I don't want to turn the head too much and risk losing that feature. He's a pretty cool little figure, and he does look just like the marionette used in the special. The Regal King Moonracer. This is a really beautiful figure. Not much in the way of articulation. Just like Rudolph, he can only move his legs and his head. Of course, he's forever going to be in that crouched pose, like he was sitting on his throne. He's got the fur mane, and his entire body is flocked. So it's got a nice, soft, flocked finish. And this figure is almost 20 years old now, and that flocking has not come off or faded, so that's a good sign. His wings and his crown are a hard plastic. I've seen some examples where these wings are snapped off, so I'm not going to try to manipulate those. But another really cool figure. And of course, I have to have the Abominable Snow Monster, aka the Bumble. This guy was pretty scary back when I was 5 and 6 years old. Of course, after Hermie removed his teeth, he became a humble Bumble. But this figure still has those sharp teeth in there. I can move the fur out of the way so you can see them. He's obviously furry all over, with his plastic hands and feet and face coming out of that fur. He can move his head just very slightly, but his arms do go up and down, and his legs do go back and forth. Now, I believe this figure is supposed to have electronic sounds, because there is a button in his belly, and there's a place to put batteries in the back. But unfortunately, I don't have the proper batteries to get him working. So I assume if those batteries are put in, he would give the Bumble roar. Memory Lane followed up with a series of action figures based on Santa Claus is Coming to Town. This line featured another extensive selection of characters from that special, including two versions of the Winter Warlock, both the evil and reformed version, and also a set featuring Fred Astaire's character of S.D. Kluger, along with his North Pole mail truck. Memory Lane was a division of Playing Mantis, and when Playing Mantis went out of business, the company Round 2 acquired some of their assets and continued to release some of the Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer figures, and continued that tradition by releasing figures based on Frosty the Snowman. This selection included Frosty, Crystal, Jack Frost, and the snow parson that officiated Frosty and Crystal's wedding. There was also a box set that included Frosty, Crystal, Millie and Chili, and a new pet snow dog for the family named Willie. Lastly, we have a toy line based on The Year Without a Santa Claus, which was sold exclusively at Media Play and Suncoast video stores. There were a series of six action figures, which included Santa and Mrs. Claus, Jingle and Jangle, and Heat Miser and Snow Miser, as well as a set of smaller scale PVC figures that included even more characters from the special, including Ignatius Thistlewhite, the mayor of Southtown, and Mother Nature. From my research, it seems that this toy line may have been started by Palisades and then taken over by NECA once Palisades went out of business. This Snow Miser is one of the NECA figures. Very nice sculpt on him, looking just like the original marionette. And he does have limited articulation. Move his head a little bit, his arms up and down, his legs, and also his feet can swivel. He also comes with an accessory, which is his cane. In the paint, they've incorporated glitter. So he's got sort of a glittery finish all over his outfit. Not on his snowy skin, just on his clothing. And here is the angry Heat Miser with that great head sculpt with that snarl and that fiery hair. He can move his head. Can move his little fists up and down. This one's obviously a little bit tight. And he can move his legs around, but he does not have swivel feet like his brother. Being that he's a little shorter and stouter, he's easier to stand up than Snow Miser. But he still incorporates that glitter in the outfit, as you can see. I was able to pick up all of these on the secondary market pretty reasonably, but if you were to try to collect a full line of any of the Rankin-Bass properties, it would be a very, very expensive proposition, whether you found them at toy dealers or on eBay. Some of the more desirable pieces, like the Giant Castle playset, can go for upwards of $500, and I've even seen some of the smaller pieces, like the mail truck from Santa Claus is Coming to Town, also going for several hundred dollars in box. So getting select characters here and there might not be too bad, but getting a full line of these is going to be very costly. And despite the popularity and the nostalgia for these characters, none of the modern nostalgia companies like Super 7 or NECA have gone back to these properties in recent years. Rankin-Bass Productions shut down in the year 2000, but their legacy is alive and well, especially around the Christmas season. And most of their specials have been released on home media over the years, including this complete Rankin-Bass Christmas collection, which contains all 18 of the Christmas specials that were produced between 1964 and 1985. And this set is available on both DVD and Blu-ray for quite a reasonable price. If you love Rankin-Bass, I highly recommend picking this one up. I'm going to end this video with one of my favorite musical numbers from any of the various Rankin-Bass holiday specials. It's called I Believe in Santa Claus from The Year Without a Santa Claus. Music by Maury Laws, lyrics by Jules Bass, and performed by Mickey Rooney and Ron Marshall. When Santa learns that Jingle, Jangle, and Vixen have traveled down to Southtown, he becomes concerned and goes out to find them. While in Southtown traveling incognito, he meets a young boy named Ignatius Thistlewhite. Seeing that Santa has a cold, Ignatius's parents invite him in for a hot meal. The conversation turns to whether the adults at the table still believe in Santa Claus. The song that follows speaks to the innocence of childhood and the importance of believing in dreams. So with that, I will say thanks for watching, have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy Holiday, and I will see you in the new year.
You say my friends were asking you about Christmas?
Yeah, they wanted to know if we kids cared about Santa Claus and all.
And what'd you tell them?
Heck, I don't believe in Santa Claus anymore. That's kid stuff, isn't it?
Just as I thought.
You don't believe in Santa Claus, do you, Dad?
Why, yes. Matter of fact, I do.
How about you?
Me? Why, of course I do. I believe in Santa Claus, like I believe in love. I believe in Santa Claus and everything he does. There's no question in my mind that he does exist. Just like love, I know he's there, waiting to be missed. I believe in Santa Claus, but there was a time I thought I had grown too old for such a childish rhyme. He became a dream to me till one Christmas night someone stood beside my bed with a beard of wine. So you're too old for Santa Claus, he said with a smile. Then you're too old for all the things that make a life worthwhile. For what is happiness but dreams, and do they all come true? Look at me and tell me, son, what is real to you? Just be Santa Claus, like you believe in love. Just believe in Santa Claus and everything he does. Wipe that question from your mind. Yes, he does exist. Just like love, you know he's there, waiting to be missed. Just like love, I know he's there, waiting to be missed.
I guess if you're not too old to still believe, well, I guess maybe...
Oh.